strike me. I've never seen a like before in my life. Something totally different from what we used up in the gates, I think. But I think when it's finished, well, it should be well worth seeing.
Well, to me, it looks a bit queer-like, but then, of course, that's the modern of architects today, isn't it?
It looks a nice one to me. I don't like the looks of it at all.
Not like the normal barrack flats that are going up just now. I'm really impressed with them. I think they're very nice indeed.
There, folks, so I thought I'd indulge myself in a little bit of northeastern nostalgia and take a look back at some brutalist architecture and the story of it in the northeast, and mainly because I've been watching this, it'd be a documentary from BBC4, some obscure place, but it was on YouTube by Jonathan, a writer called Jonathan Meads, and he was looking back at brutalism. Now, in the North Tyneside, in the northeast, we really had, when I was growing up in the 80s, we really had like a lot of brutalism up in the north, and mainly I think because it was such a Labour stronghold that there was a few kickbacks, and they began employing architects who were, let's say, sympathetic to the Soviet Union, and they drew inspiration on all of the brutalist architecture that they had in these Marxist communist countries, and they blessed us in the northeast with it, and they blessed us with a lot of it as well. It was absolutely everywhere. And what I thought was interesting about Mead's commentary on this was that he was almost heartbroken at the idea that all of these gigantic concrete monolithic monstrosities were being these cathedrals to the hideous, that they were all being pulled down and everybody was signing petitions to get rid of them all, and he didn't like that at all. Which was a bit of an interesting slant, because we didn't like it much either. As a boy, it's not hard to see why. They are absolutely hideous, and in the northeast, throughout the, mainly it began in the early 60s, and then through the 70s and the 80s, and then into the 90s. And in the 90s, the criticism against brutalism was really severe. And then when you get into the 2000s, they began pulling them down. And Meads has a slightly different look on it. He really downplayed the Marxist totalitarian aspects of it and focused in on the futurism of it, this other school of modern architecture design. And he framed it in a way that it was domineering over nature and that was communal in spirit. And I think, well, that's all very well if you don't actually have to live in one of these things. But, I suppose he's probably got quite a posh house down south somewhere. He didn't have to live in these high-rise monstrosities, which popped up all across the north, and there was a lot of them in Scotland and in London as well. And these sort of intellectuals, they didn't have to live in them. They admired them from a distance. But still, it made me think of the big granddaddy of them all as far as the northeast's concerned, and that's the Trinity Square car park, which is most famous for being in Get Carter. And in fact, people would call it the Get Carter car park. And it was gigantic, and it was absolutely shockingly ugly. And it kind of fits with the movie Get Carter, which, you know, with Michael Caine, it's a northeastern gangster movie. Because Get Carter, even the movie, is kind of depressing and gritty and dirty and downbeat, which is the exact thing that comes to mind when you see the Get Carter car park. But it was also, what it did do as well, this kind of architecture, was made the individual very small. And it made you sort of bow before its raw power. And in all fairness, it one thing you can see is that it is a very domineering and very masculine, very direct construction. It doesn't mess around. And the Northeast was absolutely cram-packed with these things. And I remember going up on in a car as a young boy, and I was obviously like into the first Star Wars trilogy. And I imagined that if the Empire came down to the northeast of England and built a car park, it would look something like the Trinity Square car park in Gateshead. And it dominated absolutely like everything on the south of the town. Because I should have mentioned, Gateshead is on the south of the town, Newcastle is on the north. Gateshead has always been the less romantic, the less interesting, kind of drab little brother to Newcastle, north of the town. And this huge colossus, this fortress, dominated the skyline to the south of the town. And it's kind of compounded Gateshead's status as being this kind of dull and depressing place. Hooked on benefits and big state and socialism, and Newcastle was like that, but not to that extent. It was a little bit better healed, and it had a little bit more going on. But when I went past it in a car as a child, I did imagine that if the Empire came down and they built a car park, that would be it. This is how it would look. And I think it's interesting to look back on it now, because it does seem like a different world. And at the time, especially as we grew up, we all complained endlessly about brutalist architecture and the way that it did dominate the scenery. You were meant to feel small as an individual around it. And then, and I think far removed from the sort of the futurism as Mead paints it, it ended up becoming associated with like bad haircuts and the greasy spoon, the dull queue. It was a drab and uneventful existence. And it's interesting now, if we think of it, that the old left, the old sort of cloth cap socialist left with sympathies to the Soviet Union, they had an investment in that. They enjoyed it, and you can see in their own philosophy, their own ideology, that they did dream of this progressive future. That this kind of architecture would be the way forward for them. That was the progressivism of the era, and it was proud and strong and outward looking. And it's a funny thing, because when New Labour got in, they got well on board with wanting to tear all that down. So you've got this situation where the new left began to purge the architecture of the old left. They couldn't stand it. They wanted it absolutely out of the way. And this is actually what happened in the case of the Get Carter car park. And what they started to build in its place, where the car park is now this really bland set of student flats. And then just down, again, about half a mile away to a mile away, down nearer towards the town, you have this giant glass slug called the Sage. And so this is, it's interesting to just contrast the two of them, and because it speaks to two different eras of the Northeast, which are roughly 30 to 40 years apart. And the new era, which was ushered in by Tony Blair and by New Labour, they bring in the very, just look at its soft curves, and it's all shiny glass, and it's full of air, and in some ways it's the complete inversion of brutalism. Now there's no concrete at all anywhere on the structure. It's all glass, and it's all steel framing, and it's very airy, and it's what you can see directly into it as well. And so what happens is that it's this neoliberal, softer architecture coming in, which New Labour were fully on board with. And then an extension of that is in the actual place of the Trinity, the Get Caught a Car Park, you now have these endless student dormitories. And so what you see is that, and the students will, of course, come from all over the world, just in the way that the giant glass slug, the sage, that too could be anywhere. It's more or less the same as that thing they've got in London, the gherkin, but then on its side. It's a similar kind of thing. It's just this time they've done it lying down. And so the architecture that neoliberalism favours is a one where everybody is welcome, but it's very ethereal, and it's got this aspect to it where there isn't a full-on formal structure. It doesn't dominate. It's like there's no substance there, because this goes hand in hand with their own ideology, because it means we're all just individuals. You can see the individuals walking around. The individual is no longer dominated by the giant slab of disgusting concrete. The individual is what it's all about. The atomized individual who's just been shopping and having a latte. Newcastle in the northeast went slightly upmarket with the new left. But the price you pay for that is that everybody from everywhere is welcome, because there's no centre point. And we see that as well with the student dormitories, which are now dominating the space. They look like one of those Chinese cities where nobody lives. It's just block after block after block of little student portals. And they're all studying economics and social sciences and advertising and all these new modern things. Whereas in the old days, it was, you know, the greasy spoon, the bloke who works in a factory, the drab, humdrum existence. And so in a way, I kind of agree with Mead, because in his documentary, Mead does point to that in brutalism, they were planting something. There was a futurism to it. They were looking forwards, and it was unapologetic. What the neoliberalist architectures, like this, all of this glass, seems to do, it's more ethereal. It's like the panopticon of that Foucault talks about, or where everybody can see inside, and everybody can see everybody at all times. And so rather than have your oppression right out in front, as in the case of brutalism, it's more subtle than that. Everybody watches everybody else, and everybody polices everybody else's thoughts and language and clothing in a way that they didn't have to when oppression is right out there in front, and it's doing it openly and honestly in the way that they did in the Soviet Union. It's actually less sinister than the all is welcome hipster style of neoliberalism, which is now the new fashion in Newcastle. And you see that popping up in Newcastle itself and everywhere else. And so the question is kind of like, do I feel nostalgic about brutalism? Well, no, I still find it pretty disgusting and pretty awful. It's just that I'm waiting for buildings to start and be built which are kind of authentic to us. And I don't think neither one of these designs are. But I do prefer my oppressors to be right out there in the open, rather than the rootless and invisible hidden hand of neoliberalism, which invites everybody in and has a happy, smiley face, while at a deeper level, at a more subconscious level, everybody is being controlled by it. So I do think it's worth getting into these things, the brutalism. Maybe we'll take another look in the future. So thanks for listening, folks.